It's truly great to see everyone here this morning. We want to welcome our visitors to the Royse City Church of Christ. We're glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. We hope that you will stay after our worship for our Bible class, and then after that, stay around so we can get to know you a little bit better. In 5 seconds, you're dead. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Where are you? Are you in a right relationship with God? Just as you did not expect me to do that, so death will come unexpectedly. We don't know. You know, the Bible makes it very clear that our life is like a vapor that appears for only a short period of time, and then it vanishes away. We don't know the day of our death. And when we do die, which is an appointment we all will keep, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, what will be our condition? I want you to think very seriously about that this morning. Many Christians are not secure in their salvation. We know that death is coming, but will we be ready when that time comes? As I said before, we don't know when it's going to happen. It will happen. We're told that 153,000 people die every day in the world. That's 107 persons every minute. Every minute, 107 people go into eternity. Just this morning, 49 people were killed in a plane crash in Kentucky. If you listen to the news, you probably heard that. Were they ready? Did they have blessed assurance? Were they knowing that today would be the day that they die? But as we sang that song, we sang about blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. When you sang that song, did you sing that with confidence? Did you listen to the words? Did we pay attention to that message? Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. There was a survey taken in a congregation of the Lord's people, a congregation of about 200 members. The question was asked, if you died within the next few minutes, do you believe that you would go to paradise and eventually heaven after the judgment? Here's the result of the survey. 10% of the congregation said they would not go. 50% said that they were unsure. 40% said that they would go. That means about 60% of the congregation, over half, did not know whether they were going to heaven or not, or were sure that they weren't going. Over half of the congregation. How can we sing blessed assurance when we have doubts? And if you're like me, we've all had doubts about our salvation. We all have. But I believe that we can have blessed assurance from the Scripture. The Scripture reading this morning is very important. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. As Paul, the apostle, is writing to the Lord's church at Corinth, he's writing to them concerning those who are stewards of God. And he says in verse 1, "Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God," talking about those apostles, those preachers of the first century who were special men, apostles. They were servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Verse 2, moreover, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful. You look at that word faithful, that means full of faith. Full of faith. A steward is one who's entrusted with some other's goods or services. He's a steward of time, property, or some object. It doesn't belong to him. And he says, we are stewards, and it's required of a steward to be found full of faith. Faithful. Verse 3. But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by a human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself. Verse 4. For I know nothing against myself, yet I am not justified by this, but he who judges me is the Lord. Therefore judge nothing, verse 5, before the time, until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the hearts. Then each one's praise will come from God. Paul is saying here in verse 4, I know nothing against myself. In other words, I don't know of any sin in my life that's keeping me out of a right relationship with God. I know nothing against myself. However, he says in verse 4, yet I am not justified by this. Because he says, he who judges me is the Lord. In other words, we are not the final judge in the matter. God is the final judge of our life, our heart, the secret things, and our motives. That's why he says in verse 5, therefore, judge nothing before the time, talking about the time of judgment, until the Lord comes. He's going to bring to light hidden things, the hidden things of darkness, and reveal the counsels of the hearts of men. Then, at that time, each one's praise will come from God. God will praise His faithful people by saying, well done, good and faithful servant. However, knowing that we are not the final judge of our own destiny, I do believe that the Bible makes it very clear that we can have confidence in our salvation. That God wants us to have confidence in our salvation. And in fact, it is detrimental and dangerous that we do not have that confidence in our salvation as the faithful child of God. It will stifle us. It will cause us not to grow spiritually. It will cause us not to rejoice as we should if we go around doubting our salvation, doubting whether we are going to be saved or not when that day of death comes. Paul, even though he says, I am not the final judge, God is the judge, He will judge me in that day, he had confidence in that salvation. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. These are the final inspired writings of the Apostle Paul. He's writing to Timothy, young gospel preacher. And he's writing to him, and he's writing the last inspired scriptures that he would write. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. He says, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. Being poured out as a drink offering was reference to the Old Testament drink offerings that you find in the book of Leviticus. And Paul is saying here, I'm already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my death is at hand. Notice his confidence in verse 7. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. See, he was faithful. Full of faith. He fought that good fight as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. He finished that race as he is using the illustration of a marathon race. And he kept the faith that refers to the gospel that he preached and that he lived. Verse 8, finally there is laid up for me. Notice this. There is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, talking about the day of judgment. And not to me only, but also to all who loved his appearing. He says, I have this crown of righteousness. It's referring to the crown that's given to the victorious person in the Olympic Games. Not a royal crown, as it were, but a garland of leaves that was given to the victor in a contest. And he's saying, this crown of righteousness I'm looking forward to, which the Lord, the righteous judge, he's the one who will judge, will give to me, but not to me only, but also to all who loved his appearing. Now, if Paul could have that confidence, and he's saying, this crown of righteousness is not just for me, it's for all who love his appearing, can we not also have that confidence as well? In saying, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. You know, sometimes we might sing a better religion than we actually live. We might sing about confidence. We might sing about assurance and then not have it. Paul is saying, I know. Does he deserve it? No. It's by God's grace, by his mercy and love. Did he earn it? No. But he says, I'm going to get it. Because I fought that good fight. I finished the race. I've kept the faith. I didn't give up. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 11 through 12. The trust is in God and in His Son Jesus Christ to save us. That's where the trust lies. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 11 and 12, Paul says he was appointed a preacher, an apostle, a teacher of the Gentiles. Verse 12, for this reason I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. He says, I suffer these things, but I'm not ashamed. Remember, he said in Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, he's not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. He's saying here, I suffer as a preacher, as an apostle, as a teacher of the Gentiles, and I suffer persecution because of that, but I am not ashamed because I know whom I have believed. Talking about God, talking about his Son, Jesus Christ, talking about the Holy Spirit. I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. There's that blessed assurance. It's in God. It's in His Son, Jesus Christ. It's in the Holy Spirit of God. Those three within the Godhead who want us to go to heaven. God is not against us. He's for us. He wants us to be with Him for all eternity. But I do believe that in our opposition to the false doctrine of once saved, always saved, no matter how you live, once you're saved, you're always saved. In our opposition to that false doctrine, we may have gone to an opposite extreme in which we just don't know. Some Christians, even some preachers, will say, you just don't know. That God is the final judge. And we understand that from 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. He is the final judge. However, there are passages in the Scriptures that let us know that we can know if we are a fruit-bearing Christian, if we are a Christian abiding in the grace of Christ, and that if we are a Christian who has not gone back into the world. The Bible makes it very clear that if a child of God, a Christian, does go back into the world, does not bear fruit, that they will be lost. John chapter 15, verses 1 through 6, Jesus said the branches that don't bear fruit, they're going to be cut off, and they're going to be burned in the fire, a reference to hell. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 4, Paul says that you can fall from grace. Literally, you can be in grace and fall out of it by false doctrine, or by immorality, or by both. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 2 through 22, we find that a person can go back into the world. Once they had been cleansed, they could go back, and it's like a pig returning to the mire and a dog returning to the vomit. That's the sickening, pitiful position a person finds themselves in when they depart from Christ and Christianity and they go back into the world. However, we need to understand this. Listen to this very carefully. The Bible makes it very clear and teaches that it is impossible for a faithful Christian to go to hell. Did you hear what I said? It's impossible for a faithful Christian to go to hell. I didn't say it's impossible for a faithful Christian to become unfaithful. But the Bible makes it very clear that for a faithful Christian, it's impossible for him to be lost, him or her. Also, the Bible makes it very clear, it is impossible for an unfaithful Christian to go to heaven. Impossible. Unless that unfaithful Christian repents of their sins and comes back to the Lord. It is impossible for a faithful Christian to go to hell. It is impossible for an unfaithful Christian to go to heaven based upon the promises of God. We must understand that the Bible teaches us that faithful Christians sin out of weakness. However, unfaithful Christians sin out of rebellion and defiance to God's will. Now, there's a difference there. The faithful Christian is striving their dead level best to be perfect. But in our weakness, we will sin from time to time. That's when we recognize sin, we confess our sin, we repent of it, forsake our sin, and keep on keeping on. The unfaithful Christian, however, is the one who sins in rebellion, holding on to one or more sins in their life that they refuse to either acknowledge or to forsake in repentance. It is not arrogance to know we are saved. It's not arrogance. It's confidence and trust. Confidence and trust in Him. Remember what Paul said? I know whom I believed, and I am persuaded that He is able. We must understand God has made promises to His people. And as the promise-giving God that He is, who will not break His covenant and will not break His promises, as Romans chapter 4, verse 20 and 21 tells us, referring to Abraham, saying he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, verse 21, and being fully convinced that that what he had promised, he was able to perform. Abraham's faith was that of which he says, I am fully convinced that what God has promised, he will perform. Now that is shown forth as a faith that we're supposed to have in Romans chapter 4. That we are convinced that God is able to do what he has promised. Does that or should that not give us blessed assurance? That even though I might fall, but if I do what he says, he tells me what to do to get back up and keep on living. That I acknowledge my sin in confession, I repent of my sins, that's a turning away from it, and I pursue righteousness. That's what I keep on doing. And if I keep on doing that, he says, I will save you. I will forgive you. Blessed assurance. Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12. I want you to look at this verse. Here's one of those promises. Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12. As the Hebrews writer is talking about how the Old Testament predicted the coming of the new covenant, he says in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12, of God, he says, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and their lawless deeds. I will remember no more. Do we believe that? Make it personal. For I will be merciful to Shawn's unrighteousness and his sins and his lawless deeds. I will remember no more. If I really, truly believe that and I trust that statement, that's confidence. That's not arrogance on my part. That's confidence and trust in Him. That He has done what He has promised He would do. I want you to turn to the book of 1 John. We find this word know. K-N-O-W. Throughout the book of 1 John. In different forms. Knowing God. And I want you to look at it in the context of certain verses. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3. John the Apostle says, by this we know that we know Him, if, condition, we keep His commandments. If a person is a keeper of the commandments of God, we know that we know Him. That's blessed assurance. 1 John 2 and verse 5, same chapter, verse 5. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. Keeping the word is keeping his commandments. Walking in the light, chapter 1. Walking in the light, trusting that blood to cleanse us as we live for him. 1 John chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. John says, and you know that He has appeared to take away our sins. He has appeared, Christ has appeared to take away Shawn's sins. And in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen Him or known Him. Your translation might read a little bit different than that, but the original language is talking about a continuous living in sin. No one who abides in Christ keeps on sinning. That's living in sin. And no one who keeps on sinning has either seen Him or known Him. You haven't seen Him in the Scriptures, nor do you know Him. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 14. 1 John 3 and verse 14. As he talks about conversion, we know that we have passed from death to life. That happened at our baptism. When we were baptized into Christ, we passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13. 1 John 5 and verse 13. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God. It's talking about Christians. It's talking about you if you believe in the name of the Son of God. That you may know that you have eternal life. And that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. If you have come to believe in the name of the Son of God, that means you believe in Him. You have submitted to Him in obedience and you're living for Him. You have eternal life and you can know it, John says. And he says, I want you to continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. 1 John chapter 5, verse 18. We know that whoever is born of God does not keep on sinning. That's what the original language is saying. They don't live in sin. But he who has been born of God protects himself. Some translations say keeps himself. The word is protects himself. And the wicked one does not touch him. the person who is born of God, the Christian who has been born of God, is one who does not keep on sinning. He's one who walks in the light, keeps the commandments, lives to the best of their ability according to the will of God. Do they sin from time to time? Yes. Out of weakness. And they recognize sin in their life. They repent of it, they confess it, and they go on. The unfaithful child of God is the one who keeps on sinning. He says, but he who has been born of God protects himself. And the wicked one, that's Satan, does not touch him. As I said before, based on the evidence of the Scriptures, it is impossible for a faithful child of God who keeps the commandments, who walks in the light, to go to hell. Impossible. However, it's not possible for the unfaithful Christian to go to heaven. This should not in any way, shape, form, or fashion give us a relaxed attitude towards sin. As 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 and 2 tells us, he says, I'm writing to you that you may not sin. Don't sin. However, if you do sin because of weakness, this is a paraphrase, if you do sin because of temptation and weakness, you have an advocate with the Father. Jesus Christ the righteous, He is the propitiation, that sacrifice for our sins, not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. He says, I want you to keep away from sin. But if you walk in the light, if you keep these commandments, if you're faithful to me, then I will cleanse you and I will receive you to glory. Remember what was said. Paul says, I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep what I've committed to him until that day. We understand that God is our final judge. He is the final judge. But we can know we are saved. I believe that is true. And that knowledge is based upon knowing and doing God's will. As was said in the lesson, this is only for the faithful child of God. If you're here in our assembly this morning and you're not a faithful child of God, it's impossible for you to go to heaven. Unless you acknowledge your sin, confess it, and repent of it, and pursue righteousness. If there's anyone here who's not a child of God, you need to be born of God. Confess your faith in Jesus Christ, that He is the Son of God. Repent of all your sins, and we can immerse you in water for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will be born of God to walk in His ways, trusting in His blood, not only at your initial conversion, not only at your baptism, but throughout the rest of your life to cleanse you. As always, the choice is yours. All together we stand and we sing.